Gaurav Jain and Siddharth Varadarajan. Gaurav Jain is a writer and editor, and he's the co-founder of The Lady's Finger and Grist Media. And we have, and he'll be in conversation with Siddharth Varadarajan. I'll just read out a little bit about him. He's a founding editor of The Wire. He was earlier with The Hindu. He's a recipient of the Ramnath Goenka Award for the Journalist of the Year. He has taught economics at New York University and journalism at the University of California, Berkeley. He also works with the Shivnadar University. I'll hand it over to you.
Okay. Thanks. Hi, everyone. Everybody got their coffee? Okay, hey, thanks IHS for inviting us, and thank you everyone for being here. We're just gonna talk, I think, for about 30 minutes or so. And then we'll open it up for questions. So Siddharth, I thought maybe to start us off, I wanted to ask you something which happened just about 10-12 days ago when you were in Allahabad at the university. I think to talk about freedom of expression and the media. Will you just tell us all a bit about what happened and
At Allahabad? Yeah, that was a year ago.
Oh, that was last year. So will you tell us a little bit about what happened and the circumstances around that?
Okay. Yeah? I suppose the context of the question is the whole question of freedom of speech, and you could say media freedom and so on. I was invited to give a talk at Allahabad University on freedom of expression, ironically, and I think right to conscience and freedom of speech. The invitation originated with the then student union president Richa Singh, feisty young woman, first time that Allahabad University had ever elected as the head of the students union a woman. And she was at that time politically unattached, so it was even more remarkable that she had been able to win that election. She wasn't aligned to any party, and she'd done a lot of work on improving things for students, particularly the women students of Allahabad University, who had been neglected all these years. And as a politically conscious person, she also took strong exception to a decision by her other executive committee members, who were ABVP, when for the inauguration event of the student union for that year, they invited Yogi Adityanath. And she said that, you know, if you want to call him to give a speech or something, that's a different matter. But you can't, he has no place at the inaugural event of the students union, which belongs to everybody, not just to BJPs or not just to ABVPs. And she protested, and as a result of her protest, the event had to be cancelled. And at some stage, she was physically manhandled, she broke her arm. So when I met her in Delhi in January last year, early January, she said, look, it'd be really nice if you could come to the campus and give a talk. And I thought it would be an important act of solidarity with this brave person. So I agreed, and after I agreed, the vice chancellor of the university wrote to me saying, wonderful, and I would like to chair your talk, and I'm going to, we're going to host it in Senate Hall, which is the most prestigious room there. So I was like, very nice. So I got on the train, and at about 5 in the morning, but we were still 3 hours away from Allahabad, I get a call on my mobile, and the person at the other end says, I'm SP City. And he says in Hindi that, you know, there's a lot of protest against your impending talk. So don't come to Allahabad. I said, well, I'm already on the train, and there's no question of my not coming. So he says, okay, in that case, he says, I've booked a room for you in the Circuit House. So please go there and meet whoever you want over there. You cannot go to campus. So I said, well, that's not acceptable, and I've come to give a talk, so I'm going to do that. And the conversation ended. I arrived at the station, and Richa and her friends were there to meet me. And they said, there's going to be problems, et cetera, et cetera. And so as it turned out, the vice chancellor who had invited me withdrew the invitation, banned the event from campus for some reason, because the ABVP issued some silly statement that I'd written a book on Gujarat. I mean, all kinds of absurd charges. I'm a Naxalite and so on. And so we decided that the program should happen anyway, But that it should happen. But if it can't happen on campus because they will physically not allow it, so there was a hall just outside the gate. So the event was held, and through word of mouth, more than 150, 200 students came. It was a great event, I thought. And after that, just to show that we will not be cowed down, we said we're going to go to campus. And I said, I'm going to meet the VC and say, why did you cancel this talk? So we entered campus, no problem. I was in the chatting to the VC, who was a very, very slippery gentleman, who insisted on hugging me and taking a picture with me and so on. And then said the whole thing was for my own safety, it had been canceled and so on and so forth. After that meeting, when we tried to leave, we were told that you can't leave. So you had these goons from AVBP who had kind of blocked various the exits of the Vice Chancellor's office, the building. And eventually, after being held captive for about an hour or so, the police had to come and extricate us. So it was kind of quite a odd thing. First time I had ever encountered this sort of an event. And I was happy to be there and happy to have spoken outside campus. But I thought it's a bit off that students or a section of students, or whether they were students or not, but politically motivated people would resort to these kinds of tactics. Now, I should say this is not confined just to the right. About a week or 2 weeks later, I was appalled to read how in Kerala, a friend of mine, T.P. Srinivasan, former IFS officer, was giving a talk, and there was some hysteria about how he's promoting WTO in education, and an SFI leader slapped him. But there the similarity ends, because SFI then expelled this lad, and no such action was taken in Allahabad. But I thought it was quite a kind of, I never imagined that I would be targeted, quite frankly, you know, for just a journalist going and writing and doing things, why they would get so riled up. But that's what happened.
So the reason I brought it up is to get a sense that in this sort of atmosphere, in this vitiated atmosphere where there's a lot of anxiety about censorship, about freedom of expression, you know, you and your co-founders struck out, and you've now established this strongly independent platform called The Wire. And I wondered if, you know, experiences like these, as well as the experience just of running The Wire every day, have the challenges of running an independent organization, news outlet, been different from what you imagined when you started off?
Well, it's been a remarkably smooth ride, easy ride, in the sense that the we haven't encountered any major difficulties, quite frankly, and certainly none that you could even remotely suggest are political strong arming or that sort of stuff. Maybe that will happen at some stage too, but as of now, I think the tone and mix that we present in The Wire, because there's a lot of, you know, there's a lot of material that's critical of the government or critical of different political parties, but there's also a lot of science. There's also a lot of stuff that you can't easily slot. We do a lot of foreign policy, and there I'm quite happy if Narendra Modi has a good initiative, like the International Solar Alliance or the India-Africa Summit. We're quite happy to give extensive coverage and, you know, highlight these as very positive things. So we managed, in the sense that it's not, but the response that we've got, and sometimes what's kind of been surprising is how when we've tried to, you know, let's say we have a story and we try to alert, because, you know, these stories achieve a certain amount of traction on social media, as you also know from Ladies Finger, which is an excellent site, by the way. You know, at some stage you do a story that you reckon others should follow, right? And so we had a great story. My colleague M.K. Venu last year went through the fine print of the budget, and we discovered in a footnote that Mr. Jaitley had amended the FCRA, the Foreign Contributions Regulations Act, the same law which is used to harass Teesta Sethalwad or Indra Jaisingh and all the critics of Modi. Jaitley conveniently amended the FCRA to exempt political donations from foreign companies or companies hitherto regarded as foreign to parties such as the BJP and the Congress from the FCRA. So by sleight of hand, in a completely, you know, devious manner, they tried to undo a High Court conviction of the Congress and BJP, because in 2014, both parties were found guilty by Delhi High Court for having illegally accepted money from Vedanta, which is a British company. So we ran the story, and then I got on the phone to various channels, and I said, look, do a discussion on this. And other than Business Standard that followed it up and even wrote an editorial, there was zero interest. And on other occasions also, I have encountered, you know, when we had a good story on, or even when it wasn't necessarily an exclusive story, but the way the CBI let off Amit Shah by refusing to appeal the discharge in the Sohrabuddin and Kausarbi murder case ought to have been a subject for studio discussions. But all my attempts to talk to editors and say, look, this is a great topic, you know, all came to naught. So we can see and we can read the pressure on the media, not so much through any control or pressure on ourselves, but from the fact that issues or themes that would in any democratic society be an obvious story and an obvious cause for consternation in the media. And you see this in America with Trump now. But a very different media terrain exists here. So big media, you know, is pulling its punches, they're trimming their sails, and will reluctantly pick something up if it has traction on social media, otherwise not. And I think that's where, so in a way, there's an intimation of the, I mean, we can see and read the terrain, and it's hostile terrain. But as far as we are concerned, maybe our size, or maybe because of the mix of content, or maybe because of our own background and, you know, the fact that we have all kinds of people writing for us, we haven't encountered pressure. The only pressure we have really is financial, because it's a not-for-profit, and, you know, so raising the kind of money that you need to do this is always a challenge. So,
hello. Okay. So, so in the absence of explicit pressure, and if you're able to do the stories you want to do, you're saying you still face the challenge of amplification or interacting with other media. So in the absence of that terrain, that sort of matured media, how do you tackle that? Once you do the story and you put it up, what do you do next?
Yeah. No, I mean, as you would also have discovered, I mean, social media is a great, it's actually leveled the playing field, quite frankly. And so we could do a story that would achieve tremendous traction. Like, I'll give you an example of a story that got picked up. Of course, we were not that we were looking for credit, but there was a story that we got off from a tweet of some guy in Bombay, that horrible Maharashtra textbook, which said that ugly girls have no option but to, you know, their parents have to get dowry. Or very problematic kind of, you know, to imagine that's in a textbook, you know. And so we did the story, and around the time we did the story, you know, within a few minutes of each other, HT also had the story up. But somehow the way we had phrased it and put the story had a lot more traction on social media. And it did very well, and it, you know, then everybody picked it up, TV, later that evening. So you know, social media does that. And I find that we have a pretty good sense now of the kind of stories that get traction. And it's disappointing sometimes that an important story where, you know, like for us, for example, science is very important. We do a lot of science. It's roughly, I would say, 1/6 of what we do. Because the whole strategy behind The Wire was that we want to fill those gaps, you know, things, areas that big media has abandoned. We want to, you know, give readers that. So, you know, sometimes those pieces are more difficult to, you know, generate excitement over. But, you know, invariably, if it's a news break, if it's well done, if it's written accessibly, even a science piece is able to, you know, through Google News or through, you know, social media, it's able to generate quite a lot of traction. We had a great day on the budget when we were not just updating as Jaitley spoke, but also critically analyzing virtually in real time, which pushed us to the number two position on Google News. So we had a great day on budget day, which is very unusual for a small site. So these are kind of tricks of the trade. You need to be able to master them. The downside of social media, of course, is the toxicity of the area, and, you know, which is an entirely different thing. But so far, were it not for social media, I don't think The Wire could have accomplished the kind of reach that it has in a year and a half, given the kind of scant resources that we deploy.
The other thing we touched upon earlier, I wanted to ask is, do you feel news organizations, including digital ones, are shaped by the cities they're founded in or operating from?
I think that's a very good question. I would say the city and the region, it's not a coincidence that you take a site like the News Minute, for example, right. Consciously South, but it's also based in South. We were very clear when we started that we didn't want to be just in North India or Delhi, but it's in the nature of where you are that it takes on. And unfortunately, in this country, national, quote unquote, is defined, it's very North India centric. So we kind of make an effort to have a lot of content from other parts of India. So we do, you know, we're quite strong on Northeast coverage, for example. But otherwise, you know, Delhi, as the national capital, as the political nerve center, leaves its imprint, and we can't get away from that. So, but Delhi as a city, and we had this, you know, we were talking about the email. You know, Delhi is one of those cities which is not quite a city, and you know, it's Delhi as an urban space. I don't think affects us in any way, but Delhi as a political nerve center, as a national capital. Leaves an indelible imprint on, I think, every media operating out of Delhi. It colors your vision. It takes you. Sometimes it's just a limitation of resources, right? I mean, we simply didn't have personnel or the resources to cover the last time. Well, the Chennai floods the last year we were okay, but this time we never got our act together when the cyclone hit. But the Jallikattu, you know, things we were able to pretty much cover and offer a lot of opinion pieces on. But I would say, you know, there is a north-south skew even in The Wire, which is a product of where we're located. There's no doubt about that.
You know, well, Vinod Mehta used to say that he's a Bombay editor trapped in Delhi. What about you personally? How do you feel about editing The Wire sitting in Delhi?
Yeah. I mean, you know, Vinod Mehta. At the end of the day, finally writes a memoir saying Lucknow boy. So he's a Lucknow boy. He spent his formative years as a journalist and editor in Bombay. You know, as part of getting ready for this session, and I was thinking about my own, you know, cities that helped to shape me, and you know, Lucknow is where I grew up, and then Delhi, and then London and New York, and then finally back to Delhi, and a 2-year stint in Chennai. And then again Delhi. So these are the kind of, you know, Delhi's home pretty much. But I would say the cities that shaped me and shaped my perspective and many of my interests, I would say, were London and New York, because you just get exposed to such a wide variety of, you know, you make friends from different regions of the world, you read and get interested in things that you don't necessarily, that may not necessarily happen if you're in India. And so I would say, when we started The Wire, the part that I was very keen on was that The Wire should also be international, in the sense that, I mean, when I was editor of The Hindu as a paper has a very international outlook. It had, when I took over, I think 8 or 9 foreign correspondents, I managed to up the count to 12 or 13. Of course, they sharply cut it back after I left. But I was very keen that this idea that Indians are only interested in what's happening in India or Pakistan or China or the US, so, you know, is not true. And that, you know, I had experience when I had, you know, a lot of what I do and I've done over the last few years is to, you know, people, I love visiting a different place in India that I've never been to before. So I'm going to Vijayawada. I've never been to Vijayawada, so I'm going to give a talk later this month. But I've given talks in different towns in India or cities where people have asked me to speak on foreign policy issues, like the war on, so I've in Patna spoken on the war on terror, in Banaras on Nepal, in Bhopal on what's happening in Afghanistan. And I found the response from people in all of these places to be actually, you know, overwhelming. The interest, not necessarily in what I had to say, but there was enormous interest. In Delhi, you have the same old, you know, 50 people at IIC, very jaded, predictable questions, everybody with, you know, strong opinions driven by nationalism. But in a place like Bhopal or a place like Banaras, you know, that hunger for what's happening and trying to understand, and I think Indian media doesn't get it. Maybe they don't get it, maybe they get it, but it's not financially, it doesn't make sense. So it doesn't make sense for Times of India to address the craving of a Bhopal reader for what's happening in Africa. right? So how do you make that pay? So you don't do it. Whereas I was very clear that since we're breaking with that financial model, we're not going to be driven by what investors or advertisers want, but we're going to use our own editorial judgment and our sense of our engagement with readers to provide material to them that would enrich their lives. So I was very clear that we're going to do a lot of Africa, we're going to do a lot of Latin America in the wire. So I was lucky that the guy who wrote for me when I was at the Hindu, Shobhan Saxena, Brazil-based, very good journalist. I said, look, start writing for the wire, and he's happy to do that. And so I think that, being in Delhi, but having lived abroad and having got those connections and that interest and so on is, I think, ultimately what has been more decisive in shaping my own outlook as an editor than necessarily what you would pick up in Delhi or, Delhi's sense of the world is very, it's very limited. So there's Pakistan looms large, now China increasingly, and of course the US, and that's it. Yeah. And it's unfortunate that even though you have, India's foreign policy is now, there's no part of the world that it doesn't touch. Yet you can have the president of an important country like Angola visiting Delhi. And there would be no coverage in the media at all. Mm-hmm. Whereas US or Pakistan, you'd have coverage 2 days before, 2 days after. So we want to try to break with that.
Okay. Speaking of the hunger of trying to understand what's happening elsewhere, like it or not, we're all transfixed by what's happening in the US right now. Every morning we wake up and look at our phones and just to see what has Trump done today.
Latest horror story.
But alternatively, also there are things like, say, the Reuters has put out a guide to cover Trump, or Slate has put out a piece about how I think bureaucrats can defy Trump's executive orders. And I'm wondering again, things like that, resistance by the media. How do you see those kinds of things?
No, I think it's been fantastic. It's been uplifting to see the response of the American press corps in general. And it's not just Slate. I mean, Reuters is as kind of mainstream as you get, but even the Wall Street Journal, for example, responding to, their view of the way things are unfolding from the point of view of journalism. Everybody feels that you're coming under pressure, you have to do things differently. And I think this is a time for the US media to go back to first principles. When Modi was elected, and in the first few months, I recall a discussion, I'm trying to remember who it was who made this point. A lot of what passes for exclusive journalism in India, essentially, well, an exclusive story invariably, if you're cynical, is invariably a story that somebody's planting on you, right? Somebody's giving you, there's a vested interest that wants that information coming out. And in India, a lot of exclusives originate from government, handouts. So if the finance minister wants to do a favor to you, you will know one day in advance. He will tell a preferred reporter, one day in advance, we have a Jan Dhan Yojana scheme that we're going to launch, right? And so ET or Times of India will say, government all set to announce new scheme. And so that will be the great exclusive, and which obviously you will not get if you're pissing off Mr. Jaitley, right? And similarly in America, if you piss off the Trump people, you ain't getting those stories. What Reuters is saying, or what New York Times or others are saying, is that, that wonderful, the piece by the CJR, Columbia Journalism Review editor, open letter, to Trump by the US press corps, is that we are going to go out and, resort to the good old fashioned enterprise journalism. You're going to dig, you're going to, investigate. And if you don't have access to a soundbite, if a minister doesn't meet you, his loss. Yeah? And I think in India, we don't do enough of that journalism to begin with. We never did it to begin with. A lot of television journalism is so driven by the need to have sound bites. So if you don't, the Congress party, for example, decided that Times Now is so unremittingly hostile to the party that they decided we're not sending spokespersons. BJP decided NDTV is so hostile to us that there was a time when they withdrew their spokespersons. Right?
Well, Trump is not sending people to CNN.
Yeah, exactly. Trump is not sending people to CNN. Now, what happens here in these channels is that they figure out, no, this is, you know, how do you present politics in a gladiatorial fashion if you don't have the gladiators, right? So, at the end of the day, you know, after 3 or 4 days of this kind of standoff, an emissary will go and meet and things will be patched up, and whatever complaint the BJP or the Congress had, some attempt would be made to address this. This happens on a daily basis. Ministers, you know, channels kill to get an interview with the minister. And ministers, the person who was expert at using this was Chidambaram when he was Home Minister and Finance Minister in the previous government. And he would, you know, he was absolutely tyrannical with a lot of these anchors. If you asked a question that was uncomfortable or which was, you know, if you were aggressive in your follow-ups, you wouldn't get a second interview. And very quickly, anchors learned this, that, you know, if you want the Home Minister on your channel to give a soundbite once in a while, then you have to play by the rules. So sadly, a lot of, you know, I would say that what the US press corps is doing is excellent. And if only in India, we would take a leaf from their book. Things are not quite as bad in the sense that Modi is very, and the BJP are very dismissive of journalism and journalists in general, particularly those who don't, you know, they have a list of enemies and so on and so forth. But that kind of daily hostility where you brand a channel by name or a newspaper, but you know, the way that Trump's been tweeting, right against NYT, Washington Post, CNN. Things haven't come to that level yet here, where the Prime Minister or Minister will say, you know, NDTV is lousy or Times of India or whatever.
Sad.
Huh?
Sad.
Yeah. you know, were things to come to that pass, I wonder whether you would see the same kind of ferment in the Indian press corps as we're seeing in America.
And do you see outside the US, you mentioned Africa, say the Global South, do you see other places where you draw inspiration from, where you see the media doing its job properly?
Yeah, I think that, you know, South Africa is a pretty vibrant, you know, so the Mail and Guardian, for example, is, you know, pretty, you know, they have just the right mix of adversarial and, you know, the attitude towards the government. Plus, of course, you know, being a paper of records, you cover all kinds of things. I would say internationally, I like, you know, a lot of what The Guardian does, which I'm sure all of us in the room do here as well. And, you know, you have the other African, you know, a few other African sites, the level, you know, it's you have a few, you know, independent websites that typically would be edited out of the US, but would cover Africa. But most of the in-country websites suffer from the same problem as the Indian media does. You know, if you look at, say, the Nigerian press, a few websites that I visited, or in East Africa, for example, you know, it's nothing that really stands out.
Right.
So I would say that, you know, the terrain globally is, you know, based on my own daily reading. You know, you have a list of, say, 6 or 7 sites that you visit just to soak in what's happening. But otherwise, the kind of investigations that you need, the kind of reporting that you need, you know, is not happening, and it's not happening at a global level.
So, you know, one option is to mollify the powers that be and get access. You wrote recently a piece mocking Venkaiah Naidu's comments about Bollywood using actors from Pakistan. So how does new media get over not getting access?
Yeah, no, I think that's a very good question, and it's hard to answer because new media, because it lacks resources typically, right? Even new media set up by established media is, you know, piggybacks on the mother brand, as it were. And what I see in a lot of new media ventures, including, you know, we also do a bit of it, is that you're actually the buzzword is curation, right? So. Right. So we kind of see stuff that's out there and you kind of reposition or repackage it. So there's a heck of a lot of repositioning, repurposing and curating that happens in on websites where, you know, stories are taken, ripped off, repackaged, which is fine. I mean, if you do a better job with this, like I thought one of my reporters, you know, the Telegraph had this story about this pigeon that was arrested by the Punjab police around the time when Pathankot, you know, completely absurd, bizarre, mad story. Finally, you know, so the pigeon was held, and finally these silly policemen, they couldn't figure out what to do with the spy pigeon. So they went and clipped its wings, you know. And so absolutely horrible story, which, you know, we'd been following it in the beginning, but then Telegraph had the story about the clipped wings. And, you know, we said, okay, since we wrote about it earlier, let's write about it again. And our story on the clipped wing, you know, the pigeon went viral the way Telegraph didn't. So, you know, a curation, if you do it properly, you know, can, or the other day we kind of, you know, HT had a story, Hindustan Times, about how the CBSC, it was a kind of misleading headline, CBSC will now test students on yoga and patriotism. Okay, so it is misleading because CBSC was introducing yoga and they were going to test you on yoga in the hope that teaching yoga and other things would inculcate patriotism. So it's very different from saying you're going to be tested on patriotism, right? So we said, okay, we'll do the story. And initially, we in a hurry, we also read the story wrong. But then we kind of said, okay, you know, HT's got it wrong. We'll improve it. And, you know, because you've done a more honest, objective, fair story, it does better. So a lot of, you know, so we do rely on original stories that the kind of big media do. And can sometimes do it better. But my fear is that as big media finds its print and television outlets less and less profitable, because advertising revenues are declining. So 10 years from now, there is no way that the Times of India, which has a huge network of reporters, will be able to sustain those reports, those reporters, you know, when the bulk of its readership has moved online and advertising revenues are coming, you know, from, you know, online advertisers, it's not going to be able to pay for that network of reporters. So at that point, what are websites going to be curating if there's no original news? So for me, the long-term goal for The Wire, and I hope for other websites, has to be that you have to develop your own independent reporting. You have to be able to have a network either of your own staff reporters or a network of reliable freelancers. And there's a great, you know, one of the best things that's happened in Indian journalism in the last 3 years is that you have an excellent ecosystem of freelancers. I don't know how they keep body and soul together, quite frankly, because the, you know, the pay is rubbish. But you know, you have people in virtually every corner of India who are trained up to a certain point, have experience, and can do a story pretty quickly. So I think the future would belong to those websites that will continue to, you know, provide new information, stories, ground reports that people can't access elsewhere, in addition to the kind of stuff that one finds much easier to do, which is commentary and analysis and so on and so forth.
So between repurposing, repackaging, reporting other people are doing, and trying to amplify whatever you produce on social media and trying to get people's attention, there is also the huge dilemma of how clickbaity do you make things? How do you deal with that?
Yeah, you know, we find that you need smart headlines, definitely. And so the EPW kind of headline or the Hindu kind of headline, like I remember, you know, it was not uncommon even 3 or 4 years ago in the Hindu to have the main edit page leader with the headline "Perspectives in Education, Part One." You know, so you know, you can't have that online, right? And we also have some clunkers. I mean, occasionally we would, you know, do a story which would have a pretty, you know, that kind of EPW-ish type of headline. But we try to make, you know, have the headline encapsulate in an attractive way what the story is all about, and invariably, you know, you end up, you know, the standard tactic is you pose it as a question, and you know, it is true that those stories do better. You have a why or a how in the headline, but then it gets kind of repetitive. But invariably, if I look, say, at stories over a month that have, you know, in the top 10, invariably there'll be two or three of those why or hows. So there's a sense in which that works, although we have to keep resisting not doing it too often. Sure. But otherwise, I think we at least, you know, with clickbait, if the headline does not deliver, if the story does not deliver what the headline promises, in the long run, it's a losing game. We don't do it. I don't advise anybody to do it, even as a strategy for gaining eyeballs, quite frankly. I keep telling my colleagues that even though we're a website and websites are meant to be fast, I would much rather be a day late on a story or 2 days late than to get something wrong, you know. And if you get something wrong, it's important to be quick in correcting it. So with that HT curation that I mentioned, for about half an hour we had in our headline also that people are going to be tested on patriotism, until a colleague, you know, clicked on the CBSA link and said, hang on a minute, this is wrong. So then we revise, but then we say at the end that, you know, we've revised the story because we got it wrong, right? So I think it's, you know, the beauty of the web is that you can do that in real time. We have great readers who, you know, when we started comments, for example, the first 6 months, we only allow moderated comments. But the first 6 months, there was a lot of filth and troll rubbish. But even them, you know, we said, okay, but initially we'll just kill them. But then I said, okay, fine, if somebody is posting a 10-line comment full of abuses and so on, so we would edit it down to one line. So if the guy says,
driving them up the wall.
So if you say that basically the guy is saying this article is no good, right? So we carry that line and all the other stuff, you know, that, you know, you guys are commies and, you know, Muslim lovers, cut all that out. And just one line. And so I found that over a 6 month period, it's worked brilliantly. The percentage of people who are just rant, rave, and abuse has fallen dramatically, and it's much easier now to moderate comments.
You're saying this discourages them?
I think it does, yeah. Wow. Yeah. at least in our experience.
I'm getting the signal. So I'm just going to ask you one quick last question. I want to read out something you wrote in March 2001.
Eeks. Okay.
The Taliban's enigmatic order to destroy all statues from Afghanistan's pre-Islamic past, including the two Buddhas at Bamiyan, have left people here saddened and appalled. Except for Taliban leaders and cadre, not a single Afghan that this correspondent met has supported the decision to destroy the statues. When you look back at that person and yourself now, do you have a sense of how things have shifted or have they shifted?
That person, the guy who wrote that?
Yep.
Okay. I have a sense of enormous regret that those days are gone. You know, my happiest days as a journalist were, I joined the Times of India in 95, and, you know, the higher you go up the food chain, the more restrictions there are on what you can do in terms of where you can go and, you know, what you can cover. I was one of those, I managed to crack the Times of India system. Times of India is notoriously conjuice company, but a manager told me that if you have an idea and you ask for dollars, you will be turned down. But if you give the rupee equivalent and you figure out how to change it into dollars yourself, wo ho jayega. So Times of India had no tradition of sending reporters to Iraq or Afghanistan. But I put in a proposal and I said, you know, it'll cost 25,000 rupees, and it was approved, right? Now I have a sense of great regret that I'm not able to. I got a call from the former president of Maldives, Mr. Nasheed, saying he wants to give an interview to The Wire. He's come to Colombo, and it's the sort of thing I would love to have done myself, but I can't dash off there. A colleague will do it. Yeah. But so that's this is part of life, that you lose those things and you can't hold on to that forever.
So if wishes were horses, where would you dash off?
Oh, right now? Tough call. But I would say, I think being in America right now would be interesting, quite frankly. But otherwise, there's no place that I would say immediately, but, you know, inevitably when you visit, I gave a talk at a conference in Buenos Aires India, Latin America, and I'd been to Buenos Aires once before as a student, and I went back there after 20 years, and it's, you know, if you ever get the chance to go there, just grab it. It's a wonderful place. And I thought, yeah, the life would be if you could be a correspondent in Buenos Aires. I don't think any foreign paper anywhere in the world, maybe a Brazilian paper would have a foreign correspondent in Buenos Aires. But I want that gig.
All right, we'll open it up for questions. The lady in the back.
question is where you started and the point at which you ended. When we start talking about free speech and we say that, okay, it's a non-negotiable thing, then at what point do we say this free speech has become hate speech and I need to put an end to it? So where would you draw the line?
Yeah, I think that's a great question because, you know, there is an issue under law, there's an issue of morality, there's, you know, and you'd have different, so what you or I would may consider immoral or unacceptable in a moral sense or normative sense may not necessarily be where the law has to draw the line. And I think if, so let's set aside what you and I find unacceptable and stick to, say, the legal. And I would say the law, I mean, in my yardstick, if you have speech which is inciting an offense, then it should not be allowed, right? But the, you know, practical problems come up in the following way, like, you know, we're discussing moderating comments. So our rule of thumb is very simple. So we allow, you know, you can criticize any piece you want, but if you're going to have a line that all Muslims are like this, right? Even if you're not abusive or inciting violence, we are not keen to publish that, quite frankly. Muslims are aise hi hain, Hindu, Kashmiri Pandits are aise hi hain. You know, they're all communal or they're all violent. So those, you know, we don't want to, as a site, be party to encouraging that. But if somebody were giving a talk on partition and saying that, you know, it's Muslims who are to blame, you can't criminalize that speech, right? I wouldn't publish that, quite frankly. Or if I publish it, I'll publish it in a way that somebody else is countering that. I would say that, you know, the legal, you know, what's permissible under law, the bar has to necessarily be quite high. And I would draw the line at, you know, speech that is, that actually incites. And, you know, if the law were to work properly, then that's exactly the way it would happen. It's a different matter that people who actually incite violence, and, you know, Gujarat was a classic case, 2002, if you read the, I've quoted those sections in the book, the Gujarat, The Making of a Tragedy. Some of the Gujarati papers that reproduced fake news, inflammatory news, definitely, in my mind, fell foul of 153. But no action was ever taken against them. And instead, you know, the threat was always against those who were pointing out the reality of the massacres. I once wrote a piece when I was at Times of India. My boss sent me on an assignment to West UP, where in the Vajpayee era, there was a whole, after Staines was killed in Odisha, there was a whole bunch of attacks on Christians in Western UP, in Mathura and Agra particularly. And I went to one of those places, and the local Bajrang Dal guy in Mathura, on the record, told me that we didn't kill that priest, but we will not rest until every Christian is driven out of Uttar Pradesh, or some words to that effect. It was inflammatory, but I decided to report it, and Times of India took it on page one, and I got a notice from the Minorities Commission of all people, saying that show cause why you should not be prosecuted for inciting hatred against Christians. I said, I'm inciting hatred? You know, and so we sent them a stinker, and then they didn't reply, and nothing happened. But that's the way the law works, unfortunately, in this country, that genuine hate speech, genuine inflammatory stuff is never made the target of prosecution. But instead, in the, you know, Tisa Sitalwad, who wrote a book for HRD ministry, where she's quoting some filth, RSS filth, about Muslims, in order to refute it, gets prosecuted, you know, they're saying she should be prosecuted. And you can have a dishonest channel like Times Now read that section, which she has reproduced in order to show how bad it is, and present it as if that's her view and how she should be prosecuted. You know, so unfortunately, the way the law works and the way everybody gets carried away in this country is very, very dangerous. I hope I answered your question.
I just want to ask you how you would advise someone who's like who wants to write, but doesn't know anyone in the media and doesn't know how to go about it.
Yeah, you know, I would say one third of our pieces are they just, you know, the equivalent of a cold call. I mean, they just land up in our inbox, and we like them, and we, you know, we have an author here, Suchitra, architect, Bangalore-based architect. You know, I get this piece in my inbox. Wonderful piece about the glass ceiling in the for women in the profession. And so I would say just pitch pieces. I mean, there's loads of, you're lucky that now, like if you were a freelancer 5 years ago, you'd have had a very tough time, right? Because virtually no paper would have given you any, would have given you the time of day, right? But now you have 20, 25 sites. And if you have a good pitch or a good, you know, but only rule of thumb, please do not send a piece to more than one place at a time. Okay, that's like the worst sin ever, because somebody will read and begin to edit, and when they say, when they write back to you, "Acha, I'm using it," and you say, no, Huffington Post already carried it yesterday, you know, then you get blacklisted. So don't do that. But otherwise, I think be confident in what you write and just send it anywhere.
My question is about readership and how diverse do you think readership of independent platforms like Wire is? And the reason I'm asking this question is because, I mean, I follow Wire and my immediate circle of friends and colleagues really follow Wire and platforms like that avidly. But I do know of other places where people don't follow it because they think either, I know you said you cover a lot of things, but either it's politically, not politically, ideologically aligned somewhere, or it's carrying too much of the same kind of stuff. And I'm asking this in the context of the whole, since we talked about Trump, you know, and there's been a, it's a very complicated story, but one of the things has been that the media has only spoken one kind of language and which did not reach out to a certain kind of audiences. So my question is, do you think it's important to reach out to more kind of audiences? Because you could just argue, you know, no point, or, I mean, how do you negotiate that space of?
No, I think, no, you put your finger on something that worries all of us, because none of us wants to be addressing our content to just a limited circle of people or people who think in a particular way. And I would say that, you know, because we do different kinds of content. So I know that our foreign policy stuff, for example, gets read very widely by people who completely disagree with our political pieces. And, you know, retired IFS people, for example, are very keen to write, even though they may support the Modi government and they know that we are critical of the Modi government. And similarly, the science pieces, we do quite a bit in agriculture. So you know, so they have circles, and I think that strategy has worked well for us to have, you know, different kinds of readerships, different kinds of readers. But you're right, the political pieces, you know, we never quite know how well a piece does and who's reading it or what kind of impact it has. Sometimes a piece that is critical, like we ran a piece, you know, one of our better performing pieces in the last week was looking at Modi's immigration policy in relation to Trump. And people often forget that Modi is the first guy to actually draft a refugee policy that excludes Muslims from the neighborhood. And so the piece has done fantastically well. I think more than like 20,000 Facebook shares. But judging from the comments, it's a lot of guys who are saying, "Oh, how dare you write this, etc., etc." And you know, what's wrong? Muslims are kept out. After all, they broke India. You know, these kinds of comments. So it's quite possible that this piece is reaching. So it's reaching a wider audience. Whether they're learning from it, I don't know. But so I think it's important for these pieces to get circulated, to engage. And I'm sure that even those who disagree with it, you know, will at least have found something of value, even if they get to vent and engage. So, you know, we've been pretty generous in carrying these comments, although, you know, if they're making too sweeping a statement about Muslims, then we would censor that or edit it out, or censor it out, actually. You know, they can't have that sort of stuff, but, you know, that's inflammatory. But otherwise, if somebody is, you know, saying that, you know, I support Modi's policy, it's fine, you know, I'm quite happy to run that. But there's also people who are arguing with those. So there's a sense in which if you have a vibrant comment section and you actually don't blank out voices that are critical, I'm hoping that that could be one way. So we have, like, there's one woman, I think she's a Bangalore-based person, because she once mailed me to ask why her comment hadn't come up. You know, we're very short-staffed, and because we moderate, it can take up to a day sometimes. And so she is critical of virtually everything she reads on The Wire. But she writes very cogent responses, And I love it. I think it's great that we carry, and then sometimes people argue with her. So I think that's a good thing. And I hope to see more of that, because that's the only way you break out of that bubble that people say lull the American media and American liberals into a false sense of security. Other than that, experimenting with different formats, like we're very bullish on media, on video, like I think most websites are. But trying to do video in a slightly different way, when we do Facebook chat, live chat, for example, it's an open forum. Anybody can ask a question, and we find a lot of critical stuff also comes that we're quite happy to engage with. So using some of these devices, I think conveying that you're open for a conversation is very, very important. If you're going to run a site that smacks down anybody with a critical view or somebody who disagrees, then that's not going to work. And so I hope that through a debate, one can move the compass a little bit and have, a wider readership that way, more diverse readership.
Yeah. Is there any truth in the notion that most of the stories in new media, they are very urban centric? And if yes, is it because of the lack of resources, or rural population is not your reader base, or is it because the urban middle class is not interested in that?
So you have sites and you have sites, right? You look at a site like Pari, for example, Sainat site.
Even Khabal area and Gaon connection, yeah, but exactly. They're also pretty North India
centric. Yeah, so it's North Indian rural. Although I would say Pari has a reasonable mix of stuff, but Khabar area, because its origins were really working with women journalists in Bundelkhand and that region, so it has that imprint. Gaon connection also is more strong in the north. So I would say that you have a few sites that are trying to do things differently. We are very keen to have rural reporting. In fact, I'm right now working on a project with essentially trying to raise a little bit extra budget on the side, so that we can have a full-time rural affairs editor, and actually be actively commissioning pieces. Because I definitely agree with you that those stories are underreported, and I don't think it's because people aren't interested. The fact is that the mainstream or the big media, they will not put out something if they can't monetize it. Right, so the Times of India discovered that, in fact, I recall these conversations with even people like Samir Jain, who was saying, or the marketing guys in Times of India, that, this story is going to come next to an ad. And, if you have this story on Farmer Suicides on page one, who will want to, the ad won't do well. So that's the psychological makeup of big media. Everything is, how do I monetize? So even though the reader may be interested, but it will not be served up to her. So that's the logic of big media, or corporate or commercial media. I'm hoping that by bucking that model and having a different kind of financial model, we can, provide things that readers want. But otherwise, your assessment is correct. I mean, the bulk of websites are urban, and even, when they, so they, and they are not just urban, they're aiming at a very urban demographic, that is in the 16 to 30 group, and they automatically assume that this cohort is not interested in rural stuff, they have their own sense of what is cool. So you can have one of these sites that has they do pretty absurd stories. They kind of chased. I don't know if you saw that piece. I think on BuzzFeed, Shah Rukh Khan took a selfie, and they decided, okay, who's this? They decided they were going to identify a particular girl because she was attractive in the crowd. This is very kind of urban city, and that too in a very warped way. And sadly, that's what's driving, because the whole idea is that if I can get enough eyeballs in that 16 to 30 age group, then advertising will follow. And as long as you're with that model of editorial judgment, you're never going to cover the kind of stories that need to be covered.
I think we're out of time. But thanks, Siddharth, and thanks, everyone.
Thank you.
Thank you, Gaurav, for the wonderful moderation, and thank you, audience, for being so engaged and wonderful. We're ending our sessions today, but...